morning and welcome back to Turning Points. I've compiled a list of 25 biblical events that changed the course of human history. And your list of events may differ from mine, but I suspect that both of our list begins with this one crucial event, creation. In the same way that the first turning point in your life was your birth, the first turning point in biblical history, in human history, was the creation of our world. The story from Scripture begins with an earth that is not yet fully formed, and into that world God enters and speaks things into existence. For instance, on day one, He speaks and brings light out of darkness. On day two, He shapes the atmosphere that covers our planet and protects all life here. On day three, He separates land masses from seabeds, and on that land, all kinds of flora and fauna from thousands of biology textbooks begin to grow. On day four, He creates the sun that gives us life and day, and the moon that controls the tides of the sea. On day five, He creates the birds that fill our skies and the sea creatures that fill our lakes and our oceans. And on day six, He creates mammal life that fills our planet, culminating on God's prized creation, human beings. At the end of all of that creative process, those 6 days, the text says that God rested, not because He was tired, but because He was finished, completed in His creation process. That process brings up a lot of questions on our end. First of all, we want to know, how old is this world that we're living in? Archaeologists and genealogists from Scripture pretty much agree that human life has existed somewhere between 6 and 10,000 years, but the age of the earth is still hotly contested in some circles. Some conservative theologians would argue that the earth is also 6 to 10,000 years old, while others, both biblical and scientific-based, would argue that our earth is billions of years old. That's a topic worthy of discussion, but outside the scope of this video presentation. Some would also question, was our earth created in 6 literal 24-hour days? Well, if the earth is billions of years old and the Bible story is to be trusted, then the days of Scripture must represent eons or periods of time and not literal days. And yet the text of Scripture seems to hint that the days talked about there are 24-hour days. Some would also wonder, how in the world did God create the earth in this fashion? Like, how in the world did He create the light before creating sun and moon? Or how did He create the earth before creating the solar system we are part of? Those questions have led many to discount the story as being fictitious. Along with that, all the other creation stories and cultures all around us make some people doubt the veracity of the biblical creation story. For instance, the Egyptians painted the interior of their pyramid walls with stories of earth floating on an endless seabed as the sun rose for the very first time. The Cherokee Indians have a story about a water beetle on a sea, an endless sea, searching for a place to land. And when he can't find any, he dives down and brings up a clump of mud, and it's from that clump of mud that earth is formed. It's real easy to read those stories and the biblical story of creation in a similar light and discount them all because they sound too far-fetched to be believable. But on the other hand, you can look at all these stories and say, human beings from the beginning of time had looked at the world around them and sought to make sense of it because they knew it came into existence not by accident, but by the power of some supreme being. It's important to explore what kind of literature we're looking at here. The creation story in Scripture is more poetry than a lab journal. A lab journal is very helpful when exploring certain things from a scientific standpoint, trying to discern truth by replicating that process time and time again. But certain things just cannot be adequately explored through a lab journal. For instance, love cannot be explored adequately in that way, or hate or despair. The creation story is really trying to discern truth about the creation through a theological lens, not to answer the question how things took place, but to answer the questions who brought it about and why it exists the way it does. So the creation story may never have been intended to answer the question, was creation accomplished in 6 24-hour days, but more likely for the process of helping us understand the God who made it happen and the reasons we exist here today. I believe that the creation story in Scripture is fully capable of making four definitive truth claims. The first one is this: our world came into existence by a very powerful God. Genesis chapter 1 verse 1 says it eloquently when it says, "In the beginning God created the heavens and the earth." Our sun is 93 million miles away from us and generates heat that sustains life on this planet. Scientists say that on its surface, the sun has temperatures ranging around 10,000 degrees Fahrenheit, and at its core, millions of degrees Fahrenheit. And our sun is just a baby sun in the scope of the universe, and Scripture says that our God spoke those objects into existence, spoke those powerful suns into existence. Here's the way Isaiah the prophet worded it. "Look at the night sky. Who do you think made all this? Who marches this army of stars out each night, counts them off, calls all by name, so magnificent, so powerful?" I think the Bible creation story is fully capable of making the claim our world came into existence by a very powerful God. The second truth claim that the creation story from Scripture can make is this: not only is God a powerful God, but He is an artistic God and a very creative God. At the end of each day's creation, God looks at the things He's made and He says, "It is good." In fact, at the end of the sixth day, God looked upon all His creation and says, "It is very good." The human brain just weighs 3 pounds. There's 100 billion neurons in the brain, each of them making millions of connections between one another every second of our lives. We've tried to mimic that complexity with modern computers, but are unable to match the power of the human brain. In fact, Stephen Smith from Stanford University makes the claim that when we examine the human brain and its complexity, it's beyond anything we've ever imagined, even to the point of almost being beyond belief. Here's what the psalmist says about the complexity and the beauty of God's creation. "How many are your works, Lord? In wisdom you have made them all. The earth is full of your creatures. There's a sea, vast and spacious, teeming with creatures beyond number, living things both large and small." God is not only powerful in His creative works, but He is also beautiful in the things that He makes. The second truth claim I think that we can make from the biblical creation story is that the human race is God's pinnacle, His best of creation. I think all of life is valuable, but for any who would equate animal life with human life, the story of Genesis tells a different tale. It says that God says, "Let us make mankind in our image, in our likeness, so that they could rule over the planet and the animals and the fish, so that they could have authority over them." And so it says this: "So God created mankind in His own image. In the image of God, He created them. Male and female, He created them." Nowhere else in this story is the detail of the importance of creation better seen than God's premier creation, human beings. And the fourth truth claim that I think that we can make from the biblical creation story is that God created us to be in relationship, not just with one another, but with Him as well. According to the story, God made man and determined that it was not good for man to be alone. And so He took a rib from the side of man and formed woman, who was going to be His companion, His equal match in this relationship. Not only in relationship with one another, God created us to be in relationship with Him. In fact, when Adam and Eve walked in the garden, God was there with them. And when Adam determined that they were going to disobey God and set off on their own, God withdrew that relationship. And humanity has, from that day forward, sought to revive that connection between the human being and the deity that created them. God made us to be in relationship with one another and also with Him. These are the four theological truths that I think the creation story in Scripture is fully capable of making, and the reason why I think it is truly a turning point in human history. For if our world came into existence merely by error, by some cosmic mistake, then every decision that we make moving forward must shift. We must turned to be more focused on self-preservation and self-elevation. But if it's true that we are here because a powerful divine being willed it to be the case, if we are made by a God who loves beauty and artistry, who sees human creatures as the pinnacle of creation and loves us dearly, if he desires to be in relationship with us and desires us to be in harmonious relationship with other people, then that changes everything about our course forward. I'd love to hear what you think are some of the key turning point reasons for the creation story in your life. And next time we get together, we'll look at the second turning point, a tragic story that forever shaped the course of human history. We'll see you then.